Hi, everyone. My name is Alex Reich, and I'm pleased to welcome you to the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine, and to our monthly webinar series, Climate Conversations, Pathways to Action. The National Academies provide independent, objective advice to inform policy with evidence, spark progress and innovation, and confront challenging issues for the benefit of society. In keeping with this mission, we're excited to host these conversations about issues relevant to national policy action on climate change. I'd like to acknowledge that the National Academy's Washington, D.C. headquarters is physically housed on the traditional land of the Nequanchitank and Piscataway peoples past and present. We honor with gratitude the land itself and the people who have been its stewards throughout the generations. We honor and respect the enduring relationship that exists between these peoples and nations and this land, and acknowledge that the expertise held by different Native communities is crucial to the work of understanding and addressing climate change. Our conversation today will be recorded and available for you to view on this webpage immediately after the event. If you'd like to ask questions, please submit them in the box below the video at any time, and we will incorporate them in a dedicated Q&A period in the final 20 minutes. We also ask that you participate in the polls that will appear in that same location and give your feedback after the event in the survey that is linked above the video. Above, you'll also find a link to register for our August 25th climate conversation about how to protect human health and the built environment in the face of more frequent and severe wildfires in the US. If you want to be notified about other upcoming climate-related activities at the academies, you can sign up for our newsletter, which is also linked above. But today, we're going to talk about how US cities can reduce emissions from transportation and improve their residents' mobility, particularly in the context of new transportation patterns at this stage of the COVID-19 pandemic and given the influx of federal infrastructure funding. I'm so pleased to be joined by John Carnegie, Executive Director of the Allen M. Voorhees Transportation Center at Rutgers University. John has over 30 years of experience in land use and transportation planning and policy at the municipal, county, and regional level, and he'll introduce our conversationalists and moderate today's event. Thank you for joining the Academies for Climate Conversations. John, it's all yours.
Thanks, Alex. It's really a pleasure to be here today to talk about the intersection of climate and urban transportation. I know in New Jersey and many other cities and regions around the U.S., transportation is really the single largest source of greenhouse gas emissions in the portfolio of sectors producing emissions. And today our talk is going to be about what city planners can do to help reduce these emissions while building more resilient mobility systems for all people, and how a policy at all different scales can support these efforts. In many ways, today we are really, I think, at a crossroads. Government agencies, as you noted, throughout the country are about to make an enormous investment in public infrastructure, a scale of which that we have not seen in generations. Over the past 2.5 years, we've all witnessed a tremendous change in economic activity and travel patterns brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. We're still really trying to sort out what all those changes kind of mean and look like in the future. And then something important to me is that I think for the first time in a long time, we've had, at the federal level at least, there is really a confluence of policies related to social justice and climate policy, health, and transportation that may provide an opportunity for transformational change in terms of improving public health, reducing emissions, becoming more resilient to climate change, and supporting equitable mobility. So our collective future really does seem at this point very much to depend on the choices that we make over the next couple of years. And the opportunity is there to chart a new course or perhaps to carry on business as usual. So it's really up to all of us, the folks that are attending this webinar and anyone in decision-making roles, and each of us individually when we make our daily choices, you know, what the future is going to look like. So I think everybody probably tuned in not to listen to me, but perhaps to listen to our guests. So without any further delay, I'm going to introduce our two expert conversationalists. I'm looking forward very much to that conversation, as I'm sure everybody else is. Today, we have with us Chris Lyban and Priya Zakaria. Chris serves as the Chief Sustainability Officer at the Los Angeles County Metropolitan Transportation Authority, and Chris's leadership at LA Metro has grown his agency's environmental and sustainability practice into one of the most progressive and forward-looking agencies in the country, and they've implemented over 150 sustainability initiatives to date. Chris is also notably the transportation chapter lead for the forthcoming FIT National Climate Assessment. I think we're going to get an opportunity to chat about that a little bit later on. Priya is the Chief Resilience and Sustainability Officer for the City of Houston. She leads the Mayor's Office of Resilience and Sustainability, which is a newly combined office focused on implementation of the Resilient Houston and Resilient Houston Initiative and Houston's Climate Action Plan. She has over 20 years of experience in design and project management, program development, land use, and transit planning and development. And she's worked in the South and Southeast of Asia and in the Middle East before moving here to the US to continue her career. So welcome both Priya and Chris.
Thanks, John.
Kick it off here with a bit of a conversation so that we can get to know you guys a little bit better, as well as give us a chance to explore the landscape of urban transportation in the context of climate change. And my first question kind of goes to both of you. If you could we'll start with Priya, if you could just tell us a little bit about your backgrounds and what brought you into the space that you're currently in.
Thank you, John. And I want to thank Chris and Alex and the whole team at the National Academy of the Sciences for this opportunity. I've been looking forward to this, to talk about resilience and transit and transportation for quite some time. So I'm excited to have this conversation. I have a bachelor's degree in architecture. So really, in some ways, I think that thinking about resilience and sustainability very factually as this combined office and with me being the chief resilience and the sustainability officer of the city of Houston is literally very new. I've been in this role for 8 months. The offices have been combined for about 8 months. But in some ways, it feels like I've been thinking about this through various opportunities for a long time. As I was starting to say, I have a bachelor's degree in architecture. And just what really struck me while I was working as an architect and a design manager was really the power of the built environment to influence how cities kind of progress and grow and how it intersects with our lives every day. I gravitated towards urban planning and transportation planning because at some point I felt that the practice of architecture really was missing for me personally, and just as a personal opinion, was missing the policy side of how we could make our cities more livable, create equal opportunity for everyone, and kind of balance with equity a lot of these decisions on resources, allocation, and investment that we were making in our rapidly growing urban centers. And I think that's kind of been the journey through architecture, through urban and transit planning, ultimately to the practice of resilience and sustainability. And I'll stop by saying one last thing. Before I came to this job, I was at Houston Metro for almost a decade prior. So again, this discussion on transportation, how it intersects with resilience, is very near and dear to mine.
Great, thank you so much. Chris, how about you? What brought you to the space?
Yeah, thanks again to the National Academies and John and Priya and Alex. Want to echo, Priya mentioned earlier. Thanks for the opportunity to talk about the solutions to these issues that we have and we're faced with. Just a little bit about myself. I'm from the Philippines. I actually grew up, in a developing nation. I mentioned that as an introduction to this conversation because, I moved here when I was a teenager, went back there to go to university, and then came back here to go to grad school, as well as, go to work, in a consulting firm. That gave me the breadth of experience in terms of looking at not only, my career, but what do I really want to do, in my life moving forward, and working through both worlds, going back to a developing nation for several months and coming back here and seeing, you know, how and what the differences are in the way we live, in the way we approach ideas and problems and the solutions, not only provided that insight, but also the venue for an innovative mind to make. I was trained as a scientist initially, as a geologist in particular, but evolved towards solving solutions as an engineer and eventually, you know, working through an interdisciplinary program, you know, at UCLA for my doctorate on environmental science and engineering. So I didn't really have too much of an experience in transportation before I came here to LA Metro almost 20 years ago now. You know, I was working through urban development, working through infrastructure, primarily the vertical space. And again, you know, the intersectionality of previous experience to what we're dealing with right now here in the agency and the many things that we need to address in light of resiliency, in light of sustainability, climate change, and most especially, you know, what it really means to the people of Los Angeles, and the people across the nation, what we do here. Not only gives inspiration, you know, but also the momentum that I need to keep many of these programs moving forward. So I'm looking forward to the conversation, and I hope that provides a little bit of context on what you'll be hearing from me today.
And I'm lucky because I have two panelists who are passionate about the subject matter. So hopefully the conversation will be easy and forthcoming. I think my first question of on the topic goes to you, Chris. You spoke of solutions just a second ago, and it'd be great to hear from you in terms of your experience as to you know, what you see as the most effective ways to reduce emissions from the transport sector, and maybe what some of the co-benefits are that come along with that, and what the trade-offs might be from different approaches.
Yeah, that's a loaded question, John, but
probably
parse it out in different parts, and then hopefully, you know, it could come together. So emissions, you mentioned earlier, you know, transportation, around 40% across the country here in Los Angeles, around the same, California around the same. And most of that is from single occupancy vehicles, right, as well as freight. And here I am, I'm a transportation agency that's not only concerned with moving people and goods around the region, a region of about 4,800 square miles or 12,300 square kilometers for those who want to look at that in the metric system. But at the same time, using transportation system as a gateway, you know, to not only uplift the economic conditions of the people of Los Angeles, but also reduce the environmental impacts, you know, that are associated with the infrastructure that is being used, you know, not only during the building, but also the operating maintenance of that infrastructure to move people and goods. So when I say loaded, you know, we have a commitment specifically, you know, just looking forward, commitment to a 100% electrified fleet by 2030. We made our board aware of the cost of that a few months ago, $3.5 billion. To do that. But, you know, at the same time, you know, there is this context of what are we really solving in terms of the issue, right? Is it the tailpipe emissions to essentially reduce, you know, the nonconformity of this region, you know, per the EPA regulations, or really to essentially create, you know, an environment, not only for our region here, but for where, you know, all of these propulsion power is produced, create an environment wherein everybody benefits, right? So given that context, and going back to the question, you know, the solution for us is multimodal. The solution for us is not just transit. You know, we look at active transportation, we look at micromobility, we look at electric vehicle chargers, we look at, you know, essentially building capacity in highways in the least environmental impactful way. And then, you know, try to address, you know, any induced demand from those highways by having other policies, you know, to essentially reduce those potential induced demands. And then, you know, while the commitment for us is to essentially electrify by 2030, you know, all of our fleet, what we've done is pretty dramatic, you know, in the last couple of years. We have transitioned, you know, to 100% renewable natural gas, you know, in the last couple of years. We're now, our buses are now run 100% renewable natural gas. So that helps out on the production side, reduction of emissions, where the propulsion power and the natural gas is coming from. And then on the tailpipe emissions, you know, we have been, you know, natural gas run buses for at least for the last decade. And then finally, you know, active transportation, as well as electric vehicles, you know, there are plans, you know, to actually enhance more of those and build up, you know, many of those capacities in transit-oriented communities that we're also encouraging around the station.
Yeah, and I think, you know, LA Metro is really, I said progressive in the in your introduction, but really impressive in terms of a more holistic approach to solutions than many agencies in throughout the country. But, you know, I'm struck by, it strikes me that you mentioned multimodalism, certainly, ensuring that the public transit fleet is lowering emissions, but the critical piece I think is figuring out how to empower people to drive less. You guys in LA, big challenge. Houston, big challenge. New York metropolitan area, big challenge. And my in the context of that, you know, empowering people to drive less. Some of the patterns we've seen over the last couple of years with the COVID pandemic have accelerated trends that maybe were there before and actually brought on new issues for us to think about. Question for Priya is, you know, how has the sort of changing mobility landscape affected our ability to reduce emissions in that way in terms of transportation usage and mobility patterns?
That's absolutely, you know, a good point and something to that, you know, something that we have to really take into consideration, what's been happening in the last couple of years, especially with COVID. So to paint a little bit of a picture, what was happening before COVID. So in 2019, Metro passed, and, you know, we looked to LA for so many things, so we did. LA passed this massive referendum. We actually, Chris, we came to LA Metro and visited with you guys, probably not with you personally, because we were in the process of putting together our own referendum for 2019, and it passed with a resounding majority. 70% of the people voted yes to more transit in the region. So that was a huge shift kind of in the thinking about transit in the region, hugely positive. And then in 2020, COVID happened. So I think the things that we have to kind of take into consideration is the Houston system, about 40%, 30 to 40% of the ridership comes from commuter ridership. And that plummeted as soon as we got into COVID, especially that first year. I think we lost about 90% of the ridership on our park and ride buses. So for those of those folks that know or don't know Houston system, the when I say commuter system, I mean park and ride buses that come in from all of our suburban locations to various job centers, but predominantly downtown. And Houston is a hub and spoke system. And so I think the way in which, and we are not probably there, you know, our systems and our processes have to be much more agile to respond to this change in mobility patterns. My personal opinion on this has not changed in the last 2 years. In the beginning, there was a lot of thinking about, do we even need transit? Everyone's getting into their cars. What is the role of transit? And I absolutely am on the other side of that opinion. Mass transit is a huge force multiplier in a city, and it's a must-have. You know, single occupancy vehicles, even if they're electrified, and that's a good thing, but we need mass transit alongside as a major investment. The home-based work trip was the king of all trips when we used to do transit modeling prior to COVID. If all of the investment, strategic investment decisions were made on that assumption that the home-based work trip, basically driving to work from home and back again, was that key trip. My take on this is people still need mobility, access, and connections and connectivity to opportunity. It may not be through that home-based work trip anymore. It's a multitude of trips. It's the grocery stores, it's schools, it's recreation, connecting to healthcare, educational institutions, and generally to opportunity. So I think the way in which we think about where to put our strategic investments has to take that into account, instead of only thinking about getting to work from home and back again. I think it's a question of agility, really. How quickly can our policy frameworks respond to that? How quickly can our measurement frameworks and how we forecast, measure and forecast ridership, be it at the state level or the local level, or even how our federal programs are organized, say with the New Starts or the Small Starts program, how you calculate benefits and costs and ridership. I think that has to probably shift towards the acknowledgement, but in many cases, I feel the jury's still out on how we collect that data and how we incorporate that into our decision-making.
Yeah, I think great point about the home-based work trip being no longer the top of the pack. Chris, has the conversation gone similarly in the LA area?
Yes and no. Yes, because the patterns that Priya had mentioned there and many of the things that we've seen are pretty much evident here as well. But in the context of who are we really talking about, right? Are we talking about professionals? Are we talking about those who are transit dependent? Are we talking about the people who or the general population, right? Because if you talk about the transit dependent population, they have no choice. I personally have a choice, but when we opened up our agency and we essentially said now people could come back to work, I have been in the past couple of years, whenever I have an opportunity, been writing our system to see how our transit dependent population is actually reacting to the policies that we put in terms of cleanliness, in terms of additional services and whatnot. At the same time, allowing, for us to actually think about, how do we reverse this trend, right? Prior to the pandemic, we have had a declining ridership to begin with. We still moved about 1.2 million people a day, before the lockdowns. At the point of the lockdown, it went down to about 200,000-300,000 people. We're now around 600,000 people. And, our board of directors and CEO's goal is to essentially bring that number back, around summer of next year to pre-pandemic levels, So I just wanted to put that in context, right? The additional thing I just want to put in there is that, because there has been, as all of us have seen, and, as this forum, exemplifies, the internet connectivity needs to be strengthened, right? And so broadband connectivity is one of those, we've never thought before that transit dollars could actually fund broadband expansion and reinforcement and resiliency. And by the wisdom of our board of directors, we were asked, staff was asked to look into the feasibility of that. And, we started that out in the South Bay area. And now, it's pretty common. And we see, such use of transportation and transit funds, to maybe becoming commonplace in the future. And one last note on this, John, because of these factors, in addition to what Priya had mentioned, transportation as we know it is changing. The baseline conditions have changed. We had the black swan, in the last couple of years. As planners think about, how the urban centers evolve over time in the transportation mix in it, things have gotten a lot different in terms of assumptions. And so therefore, the mindset on how these things are planned moving forward also need to evolve.
Great. And actually, what a great segue, because we have a once in a lifetime opportunity here with this pending infrastructure investment that's going to happen. As all of you know, the bipartisan infrastructure law starting to roll out $1.2 trillion in investment coming down, including $550 billion in new investment for transportation, broadband, a lot of different things. It would be great to hear from you how you think, let's take this question to Priya, how you think the federal infrastructure funding will sort of impact the way City of Houston is doing business, maybe the transportation agencies in Houston as well, how perhaps the infrastructure dollars will catalyze changes locally in the metropolitan area.
So I again go back to, you know, the Metro Next moving forward plan, which put $7.5 billion worth of investments, out on a referendum, and which is what passed with such an encouraging majority. Having the Metro Next plan implemented would mean transformational change for the Houston region. And that is only, you know, one can think about it as not the ultimate vision, but it's kind of phase one of all of the transit per capita, the revenue hours per capita that you need in the region, right? So Houston has a growth story. A couple of years back when we were doing the plan itself, I think the greater Houston region was projected to be at around 10 million in the 2040 time horizon. And that positive growth trend has endured. And so that is something that we have to take into consideration as we think about these transportation investments. But I think it's really where the federal government and an investment of this sort would make a transformational change is to be able to bring to bear the scale of the level of investments. One of the projects that is going to be ultimately, when it is implemented, a crown jewel for the City of Houston will be a 25-mile long bus rapid transit corridor called the University Project, previously planned as light rail transit, but now as a bus rapid transit corridor. But we've leveraged every dollar to go further with bus rapid transit. But something like that, which I think when we did the Metro Next plan, it was the overall capital cost, just as rough order of magnitude, was north of, you know, $1 billion. Something like that needs a federal infusion of funds. It is beyond the capacity of a single agency to kind of, you know, put up anything beyond the local match. But I think the effect that if federal funding bill of the scale that we are talking about for a city like Houston will be transformational, especially also from the climate front, because 47% or 49% even of our greenhouse gas emissions comes from the transportation sector. Very similar to what Chris just pointed out, it's from single occupancy vehicles. So we want to be thinking about multimodality. We want to be thinking about additional transit per capita to account for growth, but also to think about connectivity, think about coverage routes, connectivity in terms of our first and last mile connections, connections to bike routes, sidewalk accessibility. So the whole gamut of transit investments, which make sense for an individual to rely on the transit system as a viable alternative to being in a single occupancy vehicle. But the one thing I would add to that is, even as we think about this huge infusion of capital dollars from the federal government, it would require municipalities and localities to step up in terms of overall capacity to be able to not just be aware of the grant opportunities, be agile in responding to those grant opportunities, be successful in getting some of that money locally, to be able to work with the state, leadership as well, and ultimately to be able to execute. So as we think about big federal dollars, I think the thing that cities and municipalities everywhere, and transit agencies are thinking about simultaneously is to have the matching capacity, not just from the dollars and cents perspective, but in terms of resources to be able to execute and implement.
Yeah, that's a really great point. Chris, what is LA thinking about in terms of the infrastructure bill or other federal programs leveraging resources to reduce emissions and enjoy some of the co-benefits.
Yeah, Priya mentioned this earlier. You know, we have been very privileged and blessed to be trusted by LA County voters with four voter initiatives. You know, Prop A, Prop C, Measure R back in 2008, and then the recent one, Measure M. We're looking at about $140 billion worth of investments that we can create here in the region. That by itself is transformational. Measure M in particular has no sunset, you know. So by the time it's exhausted, we start all over again, you know. I pause for a second because the enormity of those dollars seem to be like, why does LA Metro need any more federal support? Just to put in context, you know, there were almost 1 million miles of rail here in the region before 1952. And then we rebuilt a few hundred, maybe up to a couple of thousand miles of that ever since. And I say that because, you know, despite what people think about our region, the dollars are coming in here because of the trust that the LA County voters have given us. It's only a down payment to the actual infrastructural transportation needs, you know, that are needed to move the 10 million people in this region, you know, and to transform the 32 plus million people across Southern California in the communities that they live in. And, you know, thanks to the federal support, you know, we somehow projected initially a structural deficit, you know, in the next few years, and probably would not be able to restore service until around fall of this year. But because of the federal government support, we're able to restore that service, you know, sooner than what we needed. In the time that we projected. Going back, John, to your question, you know, we have a tiger team essentially here that's being led by one of my staff and working with, you know, all the different stakeholders internally and externally to really identify, you know, what are the lowest hanging fruits in terms of the federal spending bill and look at that in the most unconventional way. And maybe, you know, Priya and the city of Houston and the rest of the country are doing the same thing, that, you know, what are the available dollars that could really make a significant impact, you know, to the people here. One thing I wanted to point out to, which is almost always not thought of, is an infrastructure project, a transportation project. It's not just the building and the ribbon cutting. It's actually the operating and maintaining not only of the service, but also the benefits, you know, of that infrastructure. And I mention that because, you know, in the many years I've been in my capacity here from Stafford to where I am right now, you know, that last part, you know, the operation maintenance has been, which takes up much of the funding over the life of any asset, is not even thought of, you know. People really push back if someone says we need to have that money as part of a state with repair. Yeah. So I'm mentioning that, you know, in light of your question, because, you know, while projects that we're thinking about are sexy, are things that, you know, we need here, our policymakers want to bring in here. Let's not forget, you know, that these projects are built because of the people who are using them. And at least for our LA experience, majority of the people who are using them are dependent on them. So the operation maintenance of that is critical to ensure that, you know, the benefits that we're projecting from these investments are actually real.
And I think you make a great point about the ongoing operations and maintenance, because we often think about transportation investment in terms of capital, but many regions throughout the country are often shortchanged and have more limited resources to keep everything running and to operate on a daily basis, to meet their on-time performance and all those other goals that are important to customers. That sort of leads me to think, what else might you need besides, you know, an enormous investment in capital dollars from the federal government? What types of support do you think you need from, and do other places need around the country from city and county government? You all seem to both have a strong connection between the city and the county and the progressive direction you're going. But what is it that you need from the public or city or county governments that would help make transformational change happen?
Do you want me to go first, John?
Sure.
I think, you know, transformational change, in as much as we want it to happen immediately, it does not. And I think it's a matter of moving the needle in a way that is very impactful, but it takes consistency and endurance. It's like a marathon, not a sprint, right? And so I think the kind of the conversations need to evolve between at the municipality level, at the county level, at the state level, and at the federal level. One of the things that I would like to see is more of an embeddedness of kind of the message of resilience when we talk about transit, transportation, and multimodality. I think a transit agency, by the very nature of providing an alternative to the single occupancy vehicle, is making huge strides in making it for a more resilient region. We just started calling it resilience, right? And oftentimes the association of transit and transportation is in the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions and tailpipe emissions. But if you think about it, to be able to have a choice that's other than a single occupancy vehicle, that's reliable, that's safe, that's consistent and a viable alternative to that is a huge form of resilience at a personal or a community level. And so that recognition in the messaging and the communication, how we talk about these things, I mean, how we talk about these things matter, right? And so I would like to see more of that in the dialogue between the different scales of government. And I think some of that is already happening, but I think it's like I said, it's a marathon and we need to keep at it and keep underlining those messages and pulling the message of resilience into some of the broader conversations on transit and transportation. And I don't want to leave anyone with the kind of the assumption that this is just about outreach or communication. I think ultimately all of this flows into our understanding and our recognition of how important sustainability and resilience is to the cause of public transit and mass transportation, mass electrification of our public transit fleets. And hopefully it'll have an effect on how we think about resource allocation. When we have, like for instance, in Houston, we have the Metropolitan Planning Organization, which is the joint regional entity where we discuss and kind of allocate transit dollars, transportation dollars across the region. That recognition and being able to move the needle at that level would be hugely beneficial and transformational to cities and to counties in the greater Houston region.
That's great, Priya. A lot of great points there too. Chris, reactions or agreements in terms of the—
Yeah, can't agree more with Priya, on messaging and communication. And I think along those lines, I'd like to add a couple of points, maybe a self plug, for some of our work in National Climate Assessment. A couple of things. One is, as many of us heard, multiple times when we talk about, what's happening at the local level, a lot of these solutions on climate impacts or reducing climate impacts, creating resiliency, things of that nature happen at the local level, right? And even that, on the micro scale, communities are banding together. We we've seen that in many of our communities here banding together to actually make and create, you know, programs and projects and, you know, grant applications and really harnessing, you know, every single opportunity that they can, you know, to ensure that, you know, not only, you know, their community thrive, you know, economically and socially, you know, but they're able to actually be empowered, you know, to make a difference and continue to make a difference for themselves and for the rest of their generations. So I start that, start the answer to your question that way, John, because, you know, not only is this, you know, effort, and I'll use the word in a very loose context, this fight, you know, to reduce impacts of climate, you know, not only is this personal, but it takes a collective, right? And now going back to your point, you know, that's the approach that we have taken, you know, at least in the transportation chapter of the National Climate Assessment. For those who don't know what that is, just very simply, you know, it's pretty much the state of the union of the climate of climate and climate impacts, you know, in many sectors around the country. And, you know, it's different, about 33 chapters this year, and transportation is one of the chapters. And we're looking very closely on key messages, you know, that we could tell the American people and the policymakers specific to transportation that they can carry forward, you know, to make policies in their jurisdiction. So that's kind of like in a nutshell what the National Climate Assessment is. And then going back to point, you know, what we wanted to at least say in there, I can't talk much about the details because it's still in the works, but, you know, that again, transportation is evolved, you know, because of, you know, what we have seen in the last 2, 3, 4 years, that, you know, there are co-benefits of transit, you know, there are obviously climate impacts to transit and transportation in general. And then most importantly, there are trade-offs. You know, there are trade-offs that we need to be aware of. And those trade-offs, for example, include, you know, what am I giving up, you know, if I actually, you know, buy an electric vehicle versus riding transit, you know, that kind of thing. So those kinds of elements. And in the general public, I'm mentioning this right now because, you know, in the fall, the National Academies, as well as the general public, would have an opportunity to comment, you know, on these key messages that we are, you know, putting out there for policymakers and the general public to actually think about, you know, in terms of transportation, and allow, you know, for that vehicle, you know, for that venue to, you know, make a difference in how we're moving forward. Stuff.
All right, great. Thanks, Chris. Thanks for that plug, and thanks for the important work you're doing with the National Climate Assessment. So we have gotten lots and lots of questions from our audience. So I'm going to switch at this point over to that. So bear with me as I'm toggling between my attention here. The first question, and I think this is a great question. You know, for the first time, federal transportation legislation has, and funding has included this idea such a broad consideration of equity and thinking about the impacts of transportation investments from the past and how they influence the future and such. So the Connecting Communities program that's been recently rolled out by USDOT, how are Houston and LA considering that kind of program, and how do we do more than just avoid adverse impacts and actually do something to enhance the environment for communities previously impacted by transportation investments?
So I think from the Houston perspective, this is, I mean, not just in the resilience plans where equity is a huge consideration. So I just want to say one thing though, I work on the city side. So I'm an employee of the city of Houston, and the transportation system is run by Houston Metro. So while these are two different entities, there is a great sense of collaboration between both of our offices. They were part of the work that the city did while developing the Climate Action Plan and the Resilient Houston Plan. So equity is a kind of a key principle of our resilience work. So in many cases, you know, the Climate Action Plan is a subset of the resilience work, or the resilience work is a, you know, there's no right way to do it, but it just depends on the approach. Houston took the approach of having a bigger umbrella definition of resilience, which included equity at the core, and the Climate Action Plan is almost like a subset of it. I think the question of equity in transportation investments, you know, for us, the work is really to be done in partnership with, as Houston Metro develops its projects, ensuring that the decisions on where to invest those transit dollars and transportation dollars are not just going towards providing frequency, but also coverage. Is that the frequency versus coverage debate that, you know, people are very familiar with in the transit world, as Houston even reimagined the entire local bus network. So again, going back to that example of the university corridor, the reason the alignment of the corridor is as it looks is so that that particular transit investment is able to connect historically under-resourced and underserved communities to opportunities such as educational opportunity, to job centers, to other high-frequency transit networks and so on, as well as to the commuter network that provides that kind of multimodal connection between an all-day high-frequency BRT line to your peak-only you know, express bus network, as well as connecting a lot of communities, like I said, that have been historically underserved and under-resourced. And again, I'll just underline the sense of partnership that happens between the City of Houston, our Resilience Office and Sustainability Office, as well as the city's transportation team led by David Fields, working closely with the work that Houston Metro is doing.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Priya, for that. You know, let's compare, contrast that with our experience here in the region. Equity and inclusivity has been embedded as part of our culture here from when maybe I started, you know, here almost 20 years ago. And then, you know, more formally put out there as a principle, you know, at least 5-6 years ago here through our equity framework. And in given that context, you know, really looks at, you know, not only, you know, again, moving people and goods, but using the transportation system as a gateway for all the other social, you know, opportunities that, you know, might not have been part of the conversation, you know, if not for, you know, the things that we're doing. So I'll give you some examples, you know, and people sometimes ask, like, why are you even thinking about food desert, for example, right? You know, how do you, you know, we conduct studies like, you know, like that, and access to fresh food, you know, especially in the South LA area, and try to do our transportation planning, you know, to include, you know, some of those opportunities for access for fresh food. We have this landmark study in here, our women and girl, how women and girls travel, you know, study, for example, where, you know, we looked at the travel patterns of women and girls and made adjustments, you know, to how, you know, our operators, our bus operators, you know, actually, you know, pick up and react, you know, when a woman passenger or a girl, little girl comes onto the bus, you know, and considering, you know, some of the challenges that women and girls might have, you know, as they travel from one location of the region to another, you know, and then, you know, allowing, you know, many of these opportunities to actually be measured, you know, we had, and as many cities have done in the last at least a couple of years, you know, hired an equity officer and, you know, develop a tool, you know, to actually and physically measure, you know, how these investments that we're making, you know, are making a difference, you know, in terms of equity inclusion and access, you know, in many parts of the region. And, you know, if there are shortcomings, you know, based on that analysis, you know, mitigation obviously is thought of and included, you know, as part of that project and program. And then one final thought on this one before I move on. I noticed that, you know, a significant number of our participants here today, you know, are university, college, and nonprofit organizations. I just wanted to mention that, you know, we are not foreign to working together with universities and not-for-profit organizations. Actually, at least in my programs here in the agency, you know, the significant reason why we have so many initiatives, as John mentioned earlier, is because, you know, of this collaboration, you know, with niche organizations and nonprofits and universities and their research projects that they bring to us, you know, and for us to explore the possibility of, and encouraging them with us, you know, to find a home for these ideas for us to try out.
All right, thanks, Chris. Thanks, Priya. So I think we're gonna try to switch for the last 5 minutes of our time here to more kind of rapid fire question and answer. We'll see how that works. We try to get to a couple more of these questions, the audience questions. Somebody brought up the link between land use and transportation's question is gonna be for Priya. What are you guys doing? What are our planners doing in that Houston area to address the disconnect sometimes between zoning and land use and the desire to have people drive less?
That's a great question. And I think it's something that we really forgot to touch upon, like, you know, the whole fact that there's such a huge connection between land use and transportation. So if we want transportation to be successful, you often have to work the land use angle. And as many of you all know, that Houston is a city that does not have zoning. That doesn't mean that there are no land use regulations. So I think the what we are doing from a planning perspective really is to encourage densification within the loop, encouraging infill development, and where it makes sense from the transit perspective is density and growth really mean two different kinds of transit solutions, right? So a lot of the growth that the Houston region is seeing while it's happening inside the loop, there's when I say loop, it's a ring-like freeway is 610 freeways, and if anyone wants to look it up on Google Maps. But the sheer growth and not density, though, is happening in many of our suburban localities. So I think there's from the planning perspective, there's a multitude of ways in which we are trying to think about creating more density, creating mixed uses so that those transit solutions of high frequency versus that the peak express type services to serve those would make more sense in some places than others. From the resilience perspective, I think, again, going back to this whole idea of ensuring that in as much as we invest in providing frequency, we also want to make sure that we provide the coverage services to address providing transit in neighborhoods that may not have the density, but may have a lot of under-resourced, historically under-resourced communities where there are transit-dependent communities that need transit to get around.
All right, building on that response, Priya, real quick to Chris, could you describe a little bit about what LA Metro is doing to address that issue of expanding coverage where there are in kind of low productivity areas? I know you have a number of pilot projects on different innovative transit opportunity or transit services things. Can you talk about that? Hope you're on mute, Chris.
Transit-oriented development, transit-oriented communities, you know, there's policy that was passed by the board. And then last June, our board wants us to embark on a land banking program wherein, you know, where there are plans to build in state these locations around Los Angeles. LA Metro is going to buy those properties ahead of the development, you know, not only to control the cost of that land, but at the same time, you know, ensure that we have enough, capability, just to actually build, affordable housing, for example.
That's great.
And, you know, we don't necessarily have control over the land use, but working together with the city and county of Los Angeles, we'll be able to achieve a lot of these vision that we want to do.
All right. Last question to each of you. What is the one thing that we should do in the next 5 years to reduce transportation-related greenhouse gas emissions?
Are you looking for a one-word answer, John?
A quick answer, whether it's one word or not. But
so I would say a more productive partnership.
Okay.
And I'll leave it at that.
All right. And Chris?
Forget the politics.
Forget the politics. That's good. All yep. right. All right. Two related and difficult things to do. I'm going to turn it back to Alex. Thank you all very much for a great conversation. And thank you, audience, for offering your questions. Sorry we didn't get to more of them, but I hope you enjoyed the interaction that you had here today.
Thanks, John. And thank you for your fantastic moderation. Priya, Chris, thank you for sharing from your work and thank you for your leadership on the ground. Really fantastic to learn about all the work you are doing. Thanks again to everyone at home or work for joining us today for this month's climate conversation. And as John noted, for asking so many good questions. Our conversation was recorded and you can watch it on the same webpage immediately or at your convenience later. Again, as I mentioned before, I invite you to join us at the National Academies for the next climate conversation on August 25th about how to protect human health and the built environment in both urban and rural areas in the US from increasingly frequent and severe wildfires. The link to register is above, where you can also register for the Climate at the National Academies newsletter to get updates on all the climate work we have going on. As a final reminder to share your feedback on today's event or your ideas for future events, please do take the survey, which has a link above or in the announcement below. Lastly, thank you to the climate communications team at the National Academies and to everyone behind the scenes who supported today's event. We're really, really grateful to be able to have conversations like this and hope you stay well and have a good one. Thanks so much, everyone.